Now, quite a few folks have asked me to provide some sewing instructions on how I made my cute little linen and cotton bag for storing my sourdough bread. So if you're interested in learning how to make this lined bag with a cinched cord drawing to hold a boule, you know, your nice round loaf of sourdough, then keep watching. I'll be making a bread bag for a boule, and that's the round loaf. And I could trace out the round loaf, but what I'm going to do instead to make the template for the bottom of my bag is I'm just going to use the Dutch oven. This is my Dutch oven. I bake the bread like this in the oven. And so I'm just going to trace around the outer edge of my Dutch oven, and that'll give me a pretty nice distance here for including the seam allowance, because I've got from the edge of my bread to the edge of the pan, I have 1 inch on each side. And then I'm going to use a half inch seam allowance for sewing. So then I'll have a half inch space between the edge of the bread and the side of the bag, which I think will make it nice for fitting the bread down in there. So we'll just trace the Dutch oven. And I'll just turn the pan so I get the trace on this side with the handles. Now I have a circle here, and this circle will form the template for the bottom of the bread bag. I'm going to cut this circle out. I'm using a pair of scissors that I only ever use for paper. I'm not using fabric scissors. Cutting paper with your fabric scissors will make them get really dull really quick. So here I've got the circle. This is going to be the bottom of the bag. And if I put my bread on it, you can see I've got about 1 inch all the way around. That'll give me my seam allowance plus a little bit of loose space in the bottom of the bag. You don't want your bread to compress because you're trying to get it in there. So now that we have our circle done, we need to do a little bit of math. So I've got my calculator here on my phone. We need to measure the diameter of the bag, and I can put a ruler across. I'm going to fold my paper template in half just so that I'm sure I'm actually measuring the middle and not a little bit off, because this measurement is actually pretty important. So I have my ruler now along the crease of my bread bag, and my piece of brown paper is 10.5 inches wide. Next, I'm going to need to determine for the wall of the bag that's going to go around how long that piece of fabric needs to be. So I'm going to take that measurement not from the edge of the bag, but from 1/2 inch in on each side, because this point here will be my seam allowance. And so I'm going to be sewing 1/2 inch in from the edge of the fabric as I go around. So this is the part on either side that I want to do all of my measurements from. So the part from 1/2 inch in on each side is 9.5 inches. So my bread bag, when it's finished, is going to have a browned bottom that's this length here, 9.5 inches. So I need to then use my calculator here. I just have my calculator on my phone, and I'm going to calculate out the length of the fabric that I need. So I'm going to take this inner measurement, 9.5, and I'm going to multiply it by pi. which is 3.14. And that gives me 29.83 inches. So 9.5 times pi gives me 29.83 inches. Now when I'm sewing that sidewall, that's the amount of length for it completed. So then I need to add back in a seam allowance so that I can sew the sides of the walls up. So I'm using a half inch seam allowance. So I'm going to add 1 inch, and that's going to be my seam allowance, which means that my final length to sew on this circle is going to be 30.83 inches. And the height of the bag is really going to depend upon how deep of a bag that you want. I'm going to cut my fabric so that I'm going to use 3 different types of fabric on my project. I have my outer fabric, which will be the design. I'm going to have my lining, which is going to be the linen, and I'm going to have my trim. My outer fabric and my lining are both going to be 11 inches high. My trim fabric is going to be 3 inches high, which when it's sewn will be 1 inch on either side, the inside and the outside, plus a half inch seam allowance on both sides. And then I'm also going to need the cinch portions, and I'm going to make those cinch portions so that they will be the trim too. I want to be 2 inches high. I want each one of those pieces of trim to be 6 inches long, and then I need to have a half an inch on each side to fold it over, so I'm going to make it 7 inches long by 2 inches. So these are the measurements for the bag, so now we'll just cut out our fabric. For this bag, I have 3 different types of fabric. I have a print fabric that's 100% cotton. I have my linen. This is just a natural 100% linen. And then I have a decorative accent color fabric that is also 100% cotton. And out of each of these pieces, out of the print and the linen, I'm going to cut out a circle. And I'm also going to cut out a piece that is 11 inches high and 30 7/8 inches wide. And then out of the trim, I'm going to cut out a piece that's 3 inches high and 30 7/8 inches wide, as well as 2 pieces that are 2 inches high and 7 inches wide. So next we'll do those cuts. And I want to point out to you that if your fabric has a directional print, you want to kind of respect the directional print, or else, for example, if I were to cut my fabric so that it was sideways, all my bicycles would be going up or down a very vertical wall. So I want my bicycles just sort of going across. I'm going to take that into account when I cut my fabric. I'm just marking my circle here with the pencil right on top of the linen. And then I don't want these pieces of fabric moving around on me while I have scissors and I'm cutting. So I'm just going to pin these 2 pieces of fabric together with a couple of pins. And then we'll cut out our circles. Now that my circles are cut out, I don't need these pins anymore because we're not sewing these 2 pieces together. So I've got a round circle of cotton and a round circle of linen. Next we'll cut out the sidewall fabric. I have my fabric here on my cutting mat, and if you don't have a cutting mat with a rotary cutter, you could certainly mark this out with a pencil. I just want to show you something here because I think this is kind of important. If you see, I've got my selvage edge lined up here with the edge of my mat. And so my fabric, I know, is perfectly square. And if I line it up with the grid on my board, it's not straight. So when the fabric was cut in the fabric store, they didn't actually put a straight edge on it. So I'm going to put a straight edge on it now so that my fabric is perfectly square. So now I know exactly that the edge of my fabric is perfect. And I'm going to measure down 11 inches. I'll just move that up. And I'm respecting the fact here that my bicycles are going to go around the bag and not up and down the bag. If you have a directional pattern, just think about what direction you want your pattern to go on your final bag. If you don't have a directional pattern, then it's not a big deal. Here's my piece that I want to go around the bag. I've got it cut 11 inches high. Now I'm going to cut it so that it's the length that I want, and I'm going to cut off the selvage edge first and then make my measurement from there. So I'm just going to make sure everything's square here. Now I want my fabric to be 30 7/8 inches long. I'm just going to line up my measuring tape until I get out to 30 7/8 inches. And I'm going to mark that with my pencil. When you're measuring your fabric, you don't want to tug on it, because if you tug on your fabric, you can actually distort it. So I've got my mark here, 30 7/8 inches. Have my fabric lined up here so that it's square. So I'll just cut the length. So with the bicycle print now cut, we'll move on to cutting the long piece of linen. I'll take this piece and I'll measure out the length, 30 7/8 inches. Here with my measuring tape. And now with the decorative blue fabric, I need a piece that is the same length as the other 30 7/8, but also just 3 inches high for the decorative border. And then I'll need some other pieces that are 2 inches high for the casing for the draw cord. I don't need nearly as much of this, but I'm going to cut a whole strip because I'm going to be making more of these bread bags, so nothing's going to waste here. Our parts of the bag are all cut out. I've got 2 pieces, a lining and an outer fabric of the round bottom. I have 2 pieces, a lining and an outer fabric of the side wall. Plus I have a long piece that will serve as the top trim. And then I have 2 small pieces that'll serve as the casings. So the first thing we want to do is attach our casings. So I am going to put these on the ironing board. And I'm just going to iron them so that I have a 1/2 inch on each side ironed in. And then I'm also going to iron so that I've got it 1 inch wide, so 1/2 inch on each side ironed in. So I'll iron those first, and then we will attach them to the outer fabric. I've pressed with the iron so that this top portion folds in 1/2 inch and the sides fold in, and that's on both sides. So these will sit on top and we'll top stitch those to the bag. So I've pinned down the casing for the drawstring, and I have it so that it's centered on either side, but that I also have accounted for the seam allowance that's here on this side. So there's a little bit of extra space on this side because of the seam allowance, and then I've got 3 inches from the top of the casing to the top seam here of the bag, the raw edge, and then I'm just going to flip it over and I will pin the other side identical. So we'll open this out. We have these two pieces here pinned in place. And I am going to just sew a top stitch seam very close to the edge with a matching thread. I'm lining up my fabric here so that it's pretty close to the edge of my needle. I don't want to have that too far off. And I'm just going to sew a straight line, just keep everything lined up. Attaching the casings here. And I'm going to just backstitch a little at each end. Now that that's stitched down, I can remove the pins and stitch the other side. But as you can see here, I'm not going to close off the ends. I want those ends to be open for my ribbon to close up and cinch up the bag. So this is what the first one looks like, and now I'll just do that to the second one. These ends here are open for the drawstring, but then the top and the bottom are just top stitched. Now that our top stitching is done, we can close up the sides of our bags. I'll just put this in my foot here with a half inch seam allowance, and I'm not going to bother using pins, but I've got the right sides together on this fabric. And on the outer fabric, I'm going to sew the whole side up. And I'm going to do the same thing with the lining fabric, but I'm going to stop about midway and backstitch and leave a gap of a couple of inches so that I can turn the project right side out after I assemble everything. You want to make sure you leave yourself a little bit of space for that. Now we're going to sew our circle into the bag, and the thing you really just want to be careful for is that you're actually attaching the circle to the bottom of the bag and not the top of the bag, or else it's going to be an incredibly short bag because your cinch cord is going to be way up there. So I'm just going to line up my bicycle so that I've got the tires down, that way I know that's the bottom. And I'm going to do a 1/2 inch seam allowance, and you really don't need to pin here. And actually you shouldn't pin here because pins will only get in your way. So what we're going to do is line the straight fabric up so that it's straight along my sewing machine. But this top fabric is on a curve. You can see here how it comes around. And so as we sew along, we're going to constantly move that so that that lines up, and then because we measured properly, we'll get a perfect circle. So that's why the measurement part in the beginning is so important. So I'm just going to lock my stitch here, and then as I sew down, I'm going to sew to the point where the curve starts to veer away, keep my needle down, and then lift my foot if I have to, and just bring that fabric around. But I am not tugging on this fabric because this circle is very much on the bias. So the fabric will stretch if you tug on it. Just let it lie flat, guide it, but don't actually pull on it. Lift that foot if you need to so that you don't get a pucker in there. But we're literally just sewing 2 inches. And then we're moving our fabric over so that it so that the circle lines up again. Putting that down. And you can see I've got my little magnetic guide here that's just making sure I am on the 1/2 inch seam allowance. And You could put a piece of tape there, or you could just keep your eye on the marks that are on your machine, or put a mark on your machine. I've even seen people tape a ruler in, which seems like a very good idea. Okay, we're coming around to where we got started. And everything's lining up. I can see exactly where I locked the stitches before, so I'm just going to lock my stitches again. Okay. Turn my bag right side out. We've got a round bottom all the way around. And there are no puckers in that. I mean, it's just perfect. So we'll do the exact same thing now. This is our bag. And we'll do the exact same thing to the lining. Stick crease in my edge fabric here, and now I'm just going to sew the two ends together so that I have a loop. And I'm doing this with a half inch seam allowance. And now I'm going to sew it to the top of the bag, on the outer side of the bag, and I'm going to put the right sides together. Now I'll run a seam with a half inch seam allowance all the way around the top of the bag. I'm assembling the whole bag here now. I have right sides together on this border fabric, and I'm just going to put a few pins in to the lining just to keep everything from getting squirrely on me. Okay, now I'm all pinned up. I'll be ready to go. I've got a half inch seam allowance here. Okay, this is the bag now, inside out. And because when we sewed the lining, we left a hole in the lining, we have a place where we can just turn the whole bag right side out. Here's our bag. So I've got this area here with the lining. I'm just going to run a seam right up the lining. Just doing a straight seam very close to the edge here, just to keep that lining closed off. And I can tuck down into the bag the lining, and because when I ironed that edge fabric, I pressed a crease in it, I'm now able to actually find that crease pretty easily. So what I'm going to do now is put it on the iron again, press all of my seams down, and then we'll top stitch the bag. So this is what the bag looks like now. And I have the seam pressed here at the top. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to do some top stitching just inside this edge here so that the lining is actually held into the top fabric and it's all one bag. So I have this little part of my machine that comes off, and that way I can slip this around, and I'm going to take advantage of that so that I can do one continuous circle here. I'll start at the seam, and I'm just going to line the edge of my fabric up with this mark on my foot so that I have everything kind of consistent. So the top stitching is done. I just have a border going all the way around, and be catches the lining fabric on the back side. So now when this bag is washed, it comes out of the wash, I'm going to have this nice top edge always preserved, and I'm not going to have to worry about the bag looking weird. It'll always look very nice. So the last step in assembling the bag is to put some ribbon through these channels so that we can use it to cinch the bag. I'm going to use some color coordinating beige grosgrain. And I'm just going to mark it out here so that I have two pieces that are a little bit longer than the actual bag. And I'll use a safety pin to fish it through as my fish tool. So starting at one end, and I'm using, this is 3/8 inch. I'm using a 3/8 inch grosgrain, and my channels are right now, the opening is about 6/8 of an inch because it was 1 inch, but I've got the two seams. So if you're going to use a different width or a different type of string, just keep in mind that you want your channels to be wide enough that you can actually feed those through. You could go with a narrower channel with this grosgrain. I chose to make my channel, the whole piece, 1 inch wide so that it was similar to the top border. So that was just an aesthetic decision. So I have the one piece of string in the bag on this side. And I'm just going to put an overhand knot in here at the end. And now I will feed the other piece in so that my knot's going to be on the opposite side. And I found it's easier if you actually put your safety pin in underneath the piece of grosgrain that you just did. This makes it a lot easier. You don't have to worry about getting caught up on where it's folded over in the top. Line this side up. Put an overhand knot in. There we have our bag. So, and you have your loaf of bread here. You want to put it in the bag. It fits right down in the bag, and then you can use the ends to cinch it closed, and there's our bread in a bag. So there's our finished bread bag with a nice warm loaf of sourdough bread. You could tie the top, you could make it a bow. Or you could just have your ends sort of cinched tight. But you've got this nice, easy to open bag. All of the inside is completely finished. We've got a nice round bottom in the bag. The bag looks fabulous from this side. When you're ready to cinch it up, you can cinch it up. These two ends are meeting pretty nicely on the sides here. And you have a cute little bicycle bag, a linen and cotton bag, and this should keep your bread plenty fresh. Just sitting out on the counter like this. I hope you enjoyed my little sewing tutorial here on making the bread bag. If you've made a bread bag or something similar and you have some ideas to share, then please leave me a few comments. Thanks for watching.